Thank you, everybody, for coming to the Aaron Torres Podcast YouTube page. I do have one quick favor before we get to the video that you came here for, and that is very simply this. You see that little red subscribe button below this video? Go ahead, smash that subscribe button. It really does help me. It really does help this channel grow and my audience grow. So go ahead and hit that red subscribe button. And now, here is the video that you came here for. All right, everybody, I am back. Good to be back. And I do want to switch gears. And I do want to talk about our old buddy, Dan Mullen. And we have talked a lot about Dan Mullen over the last couple weeks. But what I will say about my coverage of Dan Mullen and what's going on at Florida is I have never once said that I believe anything other than that Dan Mullen is going to be the head coach at Florida next year. Yes, the team's on a losing streak. Yes, the things have not gone well. Yes, he is chirping with the media. And yes, I did believe that coaching staff changes were going to have to be made, specifically on the defensive side of the football, where Todd Grantham, the defensive coordinator, is not getting the job done. But I believe that as long as Florida took care of business, beat the teams that they were supposed to down the stretch, that Dan Mullen was going to be fine as Florida's head coach and be the head coach at Florida going into 2022. Then Saturday night happened. Not sure how much you got to watch, but Florida went to South Carolina and lost to the Gamecocks 40-17 in what was quick, unbelievably the most shocking result from the college football weekend, right? Like, Michigan State losing is weird, but not that surprising. Alabama struggling, not surprising. Florida losing by 23 points to South Carolina that lost by 30 to Texas A&M the last time they took the field. That was the most shocking result of the college football weekend. And it also leads me to this. I will just say, up until about, I don't know, 2, 3, 4 days ago, I did not believe that Dan Mullen would be anything other than the Florida head football coach next season. I think now it's more likely than not that he is not back at all, and I think it might be best for both sides. In terms of the game itself, we'll get into it in a minute, but I do want to give kind of the 30,000-foot view on Florida because I have actually, I feel like, defended Dan Mullen probably more than most. I know he can be a little prickly. I know he can be a little weird, but when you look at the totality of what he did going into this season, it was pretty impressive, right? 10 wins his first year, beats Michigan in the Peach Bowl. 11 wins his second year, beats Virginia in the Orange Bowl. Last year, yes, it was a weird ending, but you win the SEC East. Weird loss to LSU late. You compete with Alabama, probably play them tougher than anybody in college football. And so when I looked at Dan Mullen coming into this year, I'm like, this guy is good. He's talented. He is the right coach, the right guy, the right person for this job. But man, oh man, has it gone off the rails quick. But again, like I said a minute ago, I really felt like, look, as long as he finished the season strong, he was going to be fine. And I think that's an important point to remember, is that if you look at Florida and the preseason projections, and I talked about it on this show, coming into the year, I think most of us kind of saw Florida as like an 8-4 football team. Yeah, they were really good last year, but they lost Kyle Trask, their quarterback, who was a Heisman Trophy candidate. They lost Kyle Pitts, who was a top 5 pick to the Atlanta Falcons. They lose Kadarius Toney, who was a first round pick of the New York Giants. And so it kind of felt like 8-4 was kind of felt about right for Florida this year, especially with Alabama on the schedule. And so even coming into these last few games, I said, you know what? Yes, they're 4-4, but let's look at who they're playing. They're playing at South Carolina. They're playing Samford. They're playing at Missouri. They're playing Florida State. They will be favored in all those games. They will win all these games. And we will completely forget that we ever had Dan Mullen on the hot seat and we were yelling and screaming and complaining about it. But Saturday changed everything. And Saturday changed everything for a few reasons. First of all, it wasn't just that you lost to South Carolina. It was that you got your butt kicked. And I get that there was some flu issues within the team. I don't think Dan Mullen was making excuses when he talked about it, but they had players with IVs in their arms at halftime and guys were flying on separate planes to kind of separate them from the rest of the team. And so there was some stuff working against them, but you can't lose to South Carolina 40-17 in a game where you only have 13 first downs, 3-for-10 on third down, and you're outgained by 100 yards again. Against the South Carolina team that is now 5-4, but you look at who they beat. East Carolina, Eastern Illinois, Troy, and Vanderbilt. Those were their only wins coming into the night, and now they have picked up their signature win, the big win of the Shane Beamer era. And this loss now, I believe, has completely changed everything. It completely changes everything because I believe that coming in, you could have kind of excused pretty much everything that happened, right? Yeah, you lose to Kentucky early, but Kentucky was playing really well at the time. You lose to LSU, but LSU's your rival. You don't ever want to lose to them, especially in a bad year. But it happens. You lose to Georgia, the best team in the country. And even when Dan Mullen last week was chirping at the media, that happens sometimes. You think fans, you think boosters, you think the AD cares how you're treating the media? No, just win. Nick Saban treats the media like crap. I've never heard an Alabama fan say, you know what I'd like? Nick Saban to be nicer to the media. Doesn't happen. Nobody cares. Just win. And as long as Dan Mullen took care of business, I thought he'd be fine. But this loss changes everything. And so now you start to look at the totality of things. I really do think he's gone. First of all, there's the results, and the results speak for themselves over the last year or so since Florida at one point got to 8-1 in the season last year. I told you a minute ago, they lost their last three games last year. This year, they are now 4-5 overall, which means some quick math. Dan Mullen at the University of Florida is 4-8 over his last 12 games. Beyond that, he is 2-8 in his last 10 games against Power 5 teams. So just think about that. Power 5 teams, Dan Mullen is 2-8 in his last 10 games. That includes, by the way, losses to South Carolina, Kentucky, two losses to LSU in the middle of firing Jimbo, or in the middle of firing Ed Orgeron, and the only wins that Dan Mullen has since the end of last year are Florida Atlantic, South Florida, Vanderbilt, and Tennessee. Does that sound like a guy that is going to retain his job or deserves to retain his job or shouldn't be under a little bit of fire? Because that's not really the kind of resume that you know, if you're going to your AD at the end of the year and saying, I deserve to keep this job, you got to start winning some of these games, Dan Mullen. I think on top of that, what I would be more concerned about if I was the Florida AD and why fans are frustrated, it's what I talked about on last Wednesday's episode after he had that weird press conference as it pertained to recruiting. If you remember, the whole conversation centered around Kirby Smart is recruiting at an insane level. Why are you not recruiting at that level? And Dan Mullen just said, we'll talk about recruiting after the season. And on the one hand, like, I think he's right. You can't talk about recruits until they sign, so what's the point of having the conversation? But two, his inability to sign elite players is going to be a problem. It is the problem now. It is going to be the problem going forward, and it doesn't really feel as though Dan Mullen really cares to address it. First of all, I looked it up. I think in some ways it's not quite as bad as has been reported. Dan Mullen has had the fifth-ranked recruiting class in the SEC twice since he got there, the sixth-ranked recruiting class 1 year, and somewhere usually between like the ninth and 12th-ranked recruiting class in college football. So this guy isn't just like not even trying on the recruiting trail, but at the same time, it's about psyche, it's about attitude, and it is also, and this matters, who you're competing against. You could probably get away with having the 12th best recruiting class in college football if you're in the Big 12, if you're in the Big 10 even, if you're in the Pac-12, if you're certainly in the ACC. But in the SEC, it ain't going to cut it. Georgia's competing for a recruiting championship every single year. They usually sign either the first or second best class in the country. Alabama, best class in the country pretty much every year since Nick Saban's taken over. The only years that they haven't is when Kirby Smart took over. Jimbo Fisher now has a top five class in the country, just signed the number one player or got a commitment from the number one player in the country this weekend, Walter Nolan, a defensive tackle from Tennessee. Three elite recruiters, three elite programs, and the three programs that right now are having the most success in the conference. I go back to what I said last week. Even Coach O at LSU, you can criticize him for a lot of things. That guy recruited his butt off at LSU. And Dan Mullen's just not getting the job done with fringe top five classes in the SEC, fringe top 10 classes in college football. That might not sound that bad, but I'm just telling you, there is a difference between the first, second, third class in the country and the 9th, 10th, 11th class in the country. Don't believe me? What's the difference between Ohio State and Michigan? Michigan has really good players, players that are good enough to beat Indiana and Northwestern and most some years Michigan State and some years Maryland and whoever. It's not good enough to beat Ohio State. Ohio State has a number 1, 2, 3 recruiting class every year. Michigan has number 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. And that's the difference. And that's the difference between what Florida is competing with and what Georgia is competing with. Finally, what I would say is in terms of this Dan Mullen present and future conversation, I think it's also worth noting. It's one thing if the school wants to fire you. It's another thing if, or not, I don't even want to say fire you, but if they're ready to move on. It's another thing if you appear to be ready to move on too. And this was something I didn't talk about on the show last week, but first of all, even dating back to last year, Dan Mullen's name was linked to a lot of NFL jobs. And I think I talked about it on the show at that time, but it was interesting because Dan Mullen's name was linked to a lot of jobs. As best as I can tell, I don't think he interviewed for any of them. And so what that tells me is that was his agent leaking his name to try to create interest in NFL circles in Dan Mullen. And that cycle started again last week. If you didn't see it, Rick Neuheisel, the announcer at CBS, said, yeah, I'm friends with Dan Mullen, and I know for a fact he would leave for the NFL if the opportunity presented itself. Do you think Rick Neuheisel just said that for no particular reason? Or do you think Rick Neuheisel said that because he knew that Dan Mullen wanted that information out there and he was doing his buddy a solid? And so you add in the fact that this program is clearly going in the wrong direction, 2-8 against their last 10 Power 5 teams, 4-8 in their last 12 games overall. The fact that the clear answer is you have to be more committed on the recruiting trail and Dan Mullen doesn't seem interested. And now the fact that it seems pretty clear that Dan Mullen wants out and is trying to find a way out, this is getting really ugly really quick. The last little thought I would say, Dan Mullen actually has a buyout that is $12 million this year. It sounds like a lot, but I'll give credit Andy Staples from The Athletic. I heard him say this, or maybe he tweeted it, I can't remember. It's a $12 million buyout, but it's interesting because Dan Mullen, if he was fired today, would only be owed $6 million up front and then $1 million for each of the next 6 years. And I know that's just a lot of money to you. That's a lot of money to me. But for a college football SEC firing, $7 million in 1 year is not that bad. And it would obviously be offset. And they obviously wouldn't have to pay if he got another job somewhere else. And so I don't want to belabor the point. I don't want to keep going. But what I would tell you is this. Yes, things can get right if they start by beating Samford this weekend, take care of Missouri, take care of Florida State. That still only gets them to 7-5 in the year. But this is an ever-evolving story. And this is an ever-evolving story, and it could make the coaching carousel that much more fascinating. Because coming into the year, we saw the scenario where LSU could open. We saw the scenario where USC could open. But now, Florida, another top 10-ish type job, could potentially open up completely out of nowhere a year after they win the SEC East? I don't know if it's going to happen. But I will tell you, it has never felt more likely than it did after this past Saturday when Dan Mullen and Florida lose to South Carolina. Again, it's one thing to lose to Kentucky when Kentucky's 5-0. It's one thing to lose to LSU. But you lose to South Carolina under a first-year head coach. This is fascinating. It appears as though Dan Mullen doesn't want to be there. And now I got to wonder, how much longer do these two sides try to figure it out? Or is Dan Mullen just going to be out of a job? Or is Florida going to be looking for a new head coach, however it works out, by the end of this year? If you enjoyed this video, do me a quick favor. Make sure to subscribe to the Aaron Torres Podcast YouTube channel. Also, make sure you're following on social media @Aaron_Torres on Twitter, @AaronTorresPod on Instagram.